It is 7:30. I'd like to welcome everyone to the planning board member meeting for June 13th, 2016. I'd like to thank HCAM for recording the meeting. We're missing one member today. Fran's not here. We have two primary things on the agenda. First is 151 Hayden Rowe Street, which is a special permit for a lot with historic structures. And then we will have continued public hearing on the Pulte project on the parts that are north of 135. And then we have a lot of miscellaneous little stuff to kind of take care of as we go through things here. So we'll probably do legacy till about maybe 9:30-ish, or depending on whether we pick up some more time on our 7:35 hearing. Let's see. I'd like to start with maybe a moment of silence for the victims of the terrorist attack in Orlando. That was a horrific event that took place over the weekend. So just a moment of silence, please. Okay, our first agenda item for tonight is the board reorganization. I'll entertain motions for chairman.
I nominate Ken. I think he's done a great job. I like the way that he's organized the meetings, site plans, and I'd love to see him do it another year.
I'm willing to do
second.
It. Oh, okay. Moved and seconded. I'm willing to do it. Are there other nominations? Seeing none. You guys ready for a vote? All those in favor of, I guess, me as chairman again, and say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay, nominations for vice chairman are in order.
I nominate Brian Karp.
I nominate John
Ferrari. I'm assuming you're looking down Ferrari.
Yes, Ferrari. Thank you.
Are there seconds for either or both of those?
I second Brian Karp.
Okay.
I'm not particularly interested, but I think for vice chair we have someone who has an extended term beyond 1 year to give some continuity.
That was my.
I'm honored and thank you, and I would accept the nomination, but I would also like to accept. I know he's not here. I'd like to nominate Fran. I think that he would do a great job.
It's not here. He might get stuck with it.
I would second Fran, but I hate to do that.
I know. I hate to do it while he's not here, because maybe he doesn't want to do it. I don't know. I haven't had a conversation with him.
I haven't had a
make a motion to postpone.
Whole discussion.
Well, we can talk about it and decide what we want to do as a board, and then if he doesn't want to do it, we'll do it again.
Can make a contingent.
And is accepting it. I mean, it's. I'm hoping this next year that I make the vice chair do a little bit more work just to get the continuity going, because my second term is up and who knows what I'm going to do next spring. But I think we have a lot of members here that could easily step in and take this job if they wanted to do the extra work as chairman. So
I feel my feeling for Fran is that he's a very busy man. And he's, you know, scattered about. But if I'm entertaining the thought that,
well, who's gotten seconded so far?
If I remember,
Brian's been.
Brian too. John seconded.
Oh, okay, so we have two people going for.
If necessary, I would take the position. Okay. I've had it before.
Experience. How long did you have it for, John?
I had it for 2 years.
1 or 2 years, something like that. John is also open space chairman.
Right.
Not to say you can't be vice chairman and be an open space committee chairman, but.
And I'm willing to discuss that too.
So we have, let's see, we have two people nominated and seconded, right?
Can I second John if I've nominated someone else?
Yeah, why not? Sure.
I second.
So now we got three people in the mix. So
we should have a vote.
We should have a vote. So how are we going to do that?
Vote. Everyone should vote for one of the three candidates.
You're in charge.
Okay. Yeah.
You're
in
the board of selectmen.
You just do a roll call.
I think the audience should cheer.
Okay.
Can we have people text in?
What?
That would be a nice suggestion.
Well, let's see. There's nine of us. Let's try it. Start with Brian. You started that end. Who are you going to vote for?
I would vote for Fran.
Okay.
I'd vote for Brian.
I'd vote for Brian.
I'd vote for John.
Go. Chairman always gets to go last.
Lucky you. I vote for Brian.
I vote for John.
I vote for Fran.
Well, I'm going to make it easy. I guess I'll vote for Brian because he has the most votes of the bunch anyway, and it'll just put him over the top.
There you go.
Okay, so Brian, congratulations.
Excellent.
Okay. So that's always usually the hardest thing we do every year. But okay, the next one is a public hearing, 151 Hayden Rowe Street. This is a special permit, lots with historic structures. Come on down. You know the drill. You're missing one person, but
we're going ahead.
You're going ahead. Okay.
And theoretically, that one person, if it becomes material, can listen to the watch the videotape and participate.
Right. Okay.
First of all, my name is Doug Resnick, and I represent Phil and Donna Todaro with respect to this special permit application. I want to congratulate the newly elected members, and
thank you.
I want to express my gratitude for the folks that allowed themselves to be appointed. That includes you, Mr. Vice Chairman. This is a special permit application under 210.117.2, which is entitled Historic Structures, Lots with Historic Structures. And the overall purpose of this is to allow some exceptions in terms of normal dimensional requirements in order to preserve historic structures. There are a couple other technicalities, which are that they're not really technicalities, that the Historic Commission has to conduct a public hearing, which they did, and they voted unanimously 5-0 to support the petition in terms of finding this to be a truly historic structure. And it has to be also the subject of a pending 81P plan, which is, for all you guys who haven't already signed them, it's a approval not required plan, which we have, but we have not formally submitted, only because there's a separate time frame that runs on those. So if we're successful in having the board granted special permit, then we'll submit the check and the application, formal application, and the Mylar. this house at 151 is to the right, left-hand side of Waterfresh Farm looking at it. Okay, originally in the 90s, Phil and his wife Donna purchased the property from Dan and Charlotte Colella. Now, we probably heard of those guys. In fact, this property goes back to the mid-1800s, has only been owned by four people since then, and is listed on the Massachusetts Historic Commission ledger and on the Town of Hopkinton ledger. And then the board, Historic Commission, kind of put their stamp of approval on it and said, yes, this is a historic structure. Now, going back to the near history, the Colella family moved to Hopkinton in the 1930s, and they were a farm family. Didn't necessarily own a lot of land. We all know that across the street became Colella Farms, and that was owned by one of the Colellas. But Danny and Charlotte bought this piece of property in the 50s because Danny had a dream to create orchards on the property. So it was fields sort of like it is today, and he planted almond trees and apple trees and peach trees and all kinds of stuff. And they began selling them at the farm stand, which is right which was right here out on Hayden Rowe Street. And, you know, we know that Danny and Charlotte raised their six girls in this homestead and so forth. And the orchard became quite popular, and the girls, they looked forward to going back to school in September so they could rest. You know, because all summer they were harvesting and collecting and missing and that, and opening the farm stand really early. The farm stand building is still on the property that we're seeking to preserve. It's been moved back.
Correct.
To there.
Yes.
And then, of course, there got to be so much fruit that Danny said, the heck with the farm stand, let's have a market in town. And Colella's Market was born. I know this is true because I was told this by Dale Danahy. But at one point, Danny fell out of one of the trees.
That's true. Yeah.
He fell out of one of the trees, and Charlotte said, forget this. So they continued on just with the supermarket, and obviously it became very successful. I think we all miss it to the extent that we used to see people we hadn't seen in a long time there. So, you know, the question is, why are we asking for this? Well, we're asking for it because it's recognized as a historic property, historic structure. That certainly doesn't apply to the rest of the, you know, new marketplace, the greenhouses, all that kind of stuff. What happened when Phil and Donna and their partner were going to finance the marketplace at Waterfresh Farm was, well, we can't separate this because it didn't comply with dimensional requirements, so we'll just put our mortgage on the whole thing. The danger of that, of course, is that if, God forbid, something happened to Waterfresh, the house would go along with it and could be compromised. Okay? So all we're seeking to do is get the house back into Phil and Donna's own name. The bank 100% approves it. In fact, they're encouraging us to get this done. And so forth. So what's a little different is the fact that Phil, being the student that he is, made a chart of the properties from the high school to Chestnut Street on Hayden Road. And lo and behold,
we have them, I think.
Yeah. Do you have that?
Yes, we all have them.
Historic?
No, this
is something different. This is something Phil prepared.
What I wanted to do was just do a quick head check in terms of between the high school and Chestnut Street, are we within the realm of the neighborhood. What else exists between those two points on Hayden Mill Street? The fact is that half the properties have less than 150 feet worth of frontage, and of those that we see, and then also 43% have of those properties listed have less than an acre of property. So it's not unusual to see that. As a matter of fact, the frontage that we're proposing here is 125 feet, significantly more than many of the properties on Hayden Mill Street between those two points. And it's all zone RESB between Chestnut Street
and the underlying RESB is 45,000 foot acreage.
Through you, Mr. Chairman, what's the frontage between the two properties? So 125 feet, is that for the house, property of the house?
That would be for the house.
The house is 125 feet, and the rest
farm.
Of the farm, so greater than, I believe it's 160.
Okay, thank you.
May I, through the chair? Yeah, go ahead.
It's at least 150,
yes.
Doug, if I may ask you, I was reading somewhere in the bylaw that the house, there has to be, in order for Waterfresh to be what it is, it has to have the historical value of the house, right?
No. No. There are some agricultural, Waterfresh is a farm.
Yeah.
So it's subject to the agricultural dealings. It was at the time necessary to have 5 acres for a viable, to fit in the definition of agriculture. Of course, Phil and Jeff and Donna, they are growing hydroponically, so in fact what they need is far less. And in fact, the statute was changed recently to allow for, depending on how much of your own stuff you sold, to be recognized as engaged in agriculture if you had 2 acres. What we have done, though, is we've gone with the 5 acre for the portion that's left of Waterfresh, and it's about a half an acre for this for the lot that we're wanting to create. Now, what everybody's going to see, what if and when this special permit's granted, is no change in anything. Okay, there is what we'll do is have an easement area where the current driveway clips into the new lot by only 914 square feet. And there's nothing that if you guys all could grant easements across your residential property without affecting the dimensions. So that's what we would do. And we also felt that, and it's not required, we want to do this on a voluntary basis, is to set out some voluntary restrictions to aid in the preservation of this structure. Now, that's not mandatory in the thing. The statute, the bylaw does say if the board wants to have conditions, they can have conditions. So, I don't know if any of you have seen state and federal historic preservation restrictions.
War and peace?
Yes.
Yeah. Plus crime and punishment.
Yes.
And they're suitable for certain kinds of things, but I think what we've set out as a suggestion that the board might consider and include in the decision are the following, and I think those were all in your packet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You've got those.
And if I find it, I'll spin through. Okay, here we go. The exterior, and this I think is true of any historic building in town, except maybe some of them in the historic district, that the exterior siding and color can be altered without approval from anybody. Right now there's kind of green aluminum siding. So if Phil wanted to change that, he probably could. Similarly, there's no restriction on renovating the interior. If you want to update it, you could update it and so forth. If an addition is constructed, we would require, the decision might require, that the new construction be done in the same architectural style as the existing structure. And if anybody wants to consider demolishing any part of the building, that Chapter 125, the general bylaws, which is the demolition bylaw, be in effect. So we think that our request is really... Oh, I'm sorry. Thanks, Phil. Good thing you're here. And then what we also want to do is make sure we had some enforcement, and we had the director of municipal or assistant director of municipal inspections, building inspector, assistant building inspector, can enforce the restriction. And then if we, under Mass law, statutory law, a voluntary restriction or an imposed restriction is good for 30 years, and it's renewable for subsequent intervals of 20 years each. So we have allowed, we've suggested, that either the then owner, the planning board, or the historical commission could renew at the end of 30 years. I'm sure we're all diving for our calendars to diary that. I know I am. So that's the, that's...
It took me a second, but I got it.
Okay. So, anyways, if the board has any questions?
Let's, Brian, go ahead and ask your question, and then let's kind of go through a process.
My big question is, and I guess if that's what the statute is, you know, about the exterior siding and color, you can change it to anything you want. There's no, you don't need approval from anybody. It could be...
And that's true of other historic structures.
It depends on what they do for a
except in the district
condition. Perhaps. Well, no, we have Abbott Farms has got exterior approval. Now, basically, let me kind of try to set this where it is. We have to make a few findings. First of all, we have to find that it's a historic structure, and basically, we can do that based on what the Historic Commission has done. We have to find that it's in the harmony and general purpose of the zoning bylaw, and that we've given due consideration to promoting the public health, safety, etc. And it's not offensive or detrimental to the neighborhood. And we can vote to deny or permit this special permit, and we can put conditions on it. The first part, I think, is in fairly good area. When we get to discussing conditions, I've got something a little bit alternate. Jennifer's put together one that was in your packet, and I think that we can do something maybe in the middle. But let's start off with asking if there's any members of the public that are here to talk about this one. Do we have? Yes, sir. Go ahead and state your name and address. And
hi, my name is Patrick Sansonetti. I live essentially across the street at 154. I also own 150 Hayden Street, which is the back of my property. If I understand it, you guys are creating two different lots?
Correct.
So how does that change the zoning from RESB on the farm?
Doesn't.
The farm isn't RESB.
It doesn't. It doesn't.
But no one lives there.
Through the chair?
Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, the to answer Patrick's question, the farm exists largely free of zoning requirements because it is agricultural. RESB normal requirements are an acre, 45,000 feet of land, and 150 feet of frontage. So we don't have to do anything to ask for an exception for the farm. In fact, the farm has well over 45,000 feet and has 150 feet of frontage under this new plan. It's the house with the historic structure on it that's going to vary slightly from what the requirements are.
So the follow-up to that is, if these are now on separate lots, you can sell one off versus the other. Versus if they're all on one lot, it's all contained.
That's correct. That's correct.
Right, and again, part of the concern, I mean, Phil and Donna would like to own their house, through the chair, would like to own their own home, but also feel that the best way of preserving the house is to put it on its own lot, with subject to this special permit and conditions which the board finds are appropriate, and keep things basically as they are. When we look at this afterward, you're not going to see anything different from what you see today, Patrick.
Sure, today, but going forward, it seems to me, and this is my opinion, of course, that now this frees up Phil and Donna, who we're friendly with, to see them all the time, to sell off either one of these properties and not be residents to either one. Is that a true statement, that you can sell off the farm property and or the house?
Yes, that would be true. And the house would be subject to whatever the conditions are that the board imposes.
Other questions from public?
They could do that now, just all have to go together.
Other questions from the board members? Go.
Restriction, if an addition is constructed, this particular, you're applying for it, it's a variance saying that it's not a conforming lot to begin with. I don't know if I like the fact that you can actually put an addition on it where it's already not conforming. It would seem to me that I would hope that you'd have to go through building, and building would say, I'm sorry, it's not a conforming lot, you can't add to it.
Well,
I mean, I understand you're
through the chair. The point of the special permit is to acknowledge the fact that this is a non-conforming lot.
Correct.
And to basically treat it, in the, for all other purposes, as a conforming lot. So if by some, and you know, the property is pretty tight, but it's possible to add on to the house, and if it were, it'd have to be done in the exact same style.
Correct.
But the same setbacks are
required. And through the chair again, that in addition to the house would not make the lot any more non-conforming, and that's the standard for the building inspector. If we were going to say carve off a piece of the land and give it to a neighbor, that would make the lot more non-conforming than the special permit allowed, and we couldn't do that.
Mr. Chairman?
Yeah.
Yep. I think you wanted to focus on whether it's a historic property or not. I
think that by virtue of the Historic Commission,
yep,
we got that one fairly well covered.
Okay, I just wanted to understand, yep, the document, because there's two lists. Is one of them the state and one,
yes,
of them the town?
Yes.
And what's the email about? It seems like it was done again recently.
If they had to vote specifically to it,
yeah,
in the bylaw requires that they vote specifically.
Okay, so it's just all procedural, yeah, stuff. Okay, thank,
yep,
you.
Sure. Okay, let's talk about the conditions here, and then maybe we can maybe wrap this up tonight.
Well, I asked a question,
oh,
on
go.
The stage where we left off Doug's comments.
Go.
As you guys remember, I really don't want to just separate this property. I think you guys have done great things at Water Fresh Farms. I'm very proud that it's in Hopkinton, and proud of what you guys do there. It's amazing. And I like that it's there. And that said, when it was planned and approved, it was all one lot, and that I'm not into separating these lots. I do agree it's a historical building, the original land. But when I'm hearing concerns like, well, the ownership and stuff, there could be issues. I know your lawyer understands Homestead Act. And would that be something that would be helpful in this situation for the home slash business owner?
Well, homeowner, yes. We can't have, well, there's statutory homestead rights that exist just by living in a place that you own. Whether that applies to ownership by Water Fresh Farm, I don't really know. I don't think so. I don't think Phil Dowd could, at this point, file, register a homestead declaration. Through the chair, Frank, I'd just like to ask you what your fundamental discomfort is.
Well, yeah, I was curious too. Well, my answer to my question is you don't really know if they can file homestead action.
I don't think they can.
But you did say I don't really know. So that's I don't have an answer, which is fine.
Yeah.
To answer your question through the chair,
I don't think they can.
Okay. And to answer the question through the chair,
you have another question.
Oh, yeah.
Next question.
No, that's my question.
That's it. Okay.
I think that to answer the Doug's question is that it's one property and that's how it was approved. And if in the future they don't want to live there, they can rent it out as opposed to just selling the house.
Uh-huh.
And I don't want to have issues if someone buys that property, then they have issues with the farm, the business, and it's like inviting someone into your front yard to live and then and wondering why there's issues.
Well, that's the buyer's concern.
And I totally don't understand the point.
Yeah, I don't either.
Frank, excuse me, through the chair. Suppose your house was connected to your business and you could use a bylaw like this to separate it so that you and your wife and family would know that you have the protection in addition to the protection of this being designated a historic property.
Well, good thing I have a good lawyer.
Okay.
But just, Mr. Chairman, through, yep, just a comment that I kind of agree with what they're saying here, because you do want separate
business versus residential. That's why we have separate zoning for those. We have business zoning and we have residential zoning because they're two different animals. So, I mean.
Well, I'm not sure that from the zoning standpoint it makes any difference. But just because.
Just an analogy.
Yeah. I fully appreciate why they might want to separate the lot from a financial protection of the home and whatever. However, I'm not sure that I like the two sets of conditions that were presented tonight. So I have a proposal for a combination thereof.
Mr. Chairman, I don't have a copy of what Jen prepared.
And by the way, this is on page 2 of the, right in the middle of the page.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay.
You want to get out?
We can read out the same.
Okay.
Did you have another copy from the page? Thank you. Gentlemen. Same thing. Thank you.
Now, let's kind of write in a few changes to it. Basically, Jen's requires is a full mass historic commission requirements, and that ends up being rather significant. But I think we can change a little bit if we do something like this. If it read, prior to recording the 81P or within 6 months of this decision, whatever comes first, a historic preservation restriction on the exterior of the historic house, so I'm adding the exterior of, at 151 Hayden Row, as approved by the Hopkinton Historic Commission, which brings it local, and they can be more reasonable than trying to accommodate what ends up being huge if you take a, this is the agreement with the Trust for Public Lands when and the town of Hopkinton did on the Abbott Farm house, which is huge. But and then it would be no building permits or demolition permits shall be issued for the historic home prior to the recording of the historic preservation restriction. So,
but again, when you say historic preservation restriction, the Massachusetts Historical Commission, and it's contained in the packets that you, that were part of the application, is that they've already designated it a historic structure, and in fact had much more detail about the prior
ownership.
That's
all we
want
to do is make sure it's preserved as a historic structure.
Happy to do that.
That's what we get out of the deal for segregating it out as a separate smaller lot.
Well, I think in principle we agree, Mr. Chairman.
I think you do. It's just because that's very satisfied.
But I'm not so sure.
That's livable.
Well,
so that you know, there's no intention of selling the farm or the house.
I understand, and I personally don't want to spend too much more time as a planning board worrying about what happens to the house. But that's why we have the Hopkinton Historic Commission, and they're capable of figuring out what they would like to do.
I just want to say on this one had no restrictions in the interior of the home either. It was only exterior restrictions.
Yeah. But they also had a lot of them.
Taking
care of the barn and doing all sorts of other stuff, I think, is written into here, if I remember correctly. Yes.
I'm not sure the applicant's concerned with your additions. Are you against
the
additions?
Well, I don't know. I'm just seeing them for the first time in second.
Okay.
Nor do I know. Nor am I familiar with that document, which alluded to that.
But
that's just a sample of a different.
That's one that's done basically in how the Mass Historic would approve it, because we were using CPC money to do that.
And Mr. Chairman, it's also in the historic district.
No, it's not.
97 Ash.
Yes.
It's Bill's house.
It's Bill's old house, yes. So, and they have modified it considerably since this was assigned, but under the guidance of the Historic Commission. I mean, they took all the bays off. I mean, they did a lot of work to it, and they are doing a lot. They're adding on to it as we speak. It sounds like we're beyond where we are in time. sounds like maybe it might not be the worst thing to continue it and have you have an opportunity to discuss it with the Hopkinton Historic Commission to see whether or not something can be negotiated.
Well,
or I don't know whether the board members like my proposed merger of less than Jen's and a little bit more than
which, Mr. Chairman, I don't even know what that is, by the way. I'm not being
I think it's that one paragraph that we just gave you, right?
What he just read to you.
Oh, okay.
So it's just that one paragraph, I believe.
Yep, that's correct. Prior to the recording of the 81P, or within 6 months of the date of this decision, whatever comes first, a historic preservation restriction on the exterior of the historic house on 151, as approved by the Hopkinton Historic Commission, shall be recorded. No building permits shall be issued to the historic home prior to the recording of the historic preservation. No building permits or demolition permits shall be issued to the historic home prior to the recording of the historic preservation.
No problem there, Mr. Chairman. I guess what I'm having a little bit of trouble with, just by surprise, is that you're citing one paragraph, and then there is this restriction agreement.
That's just an example.
No, that's an example.
We are not recommending that as part of it.
Okay, just this.
Yes.
That's all we're going to put in it.
Okay.
And then you're going to have to negotiate with the Historic Commission
to
come up with something that's
worth it.
And I don't want anyone to think that this was part of what it is.
Okay.
Mr. Abbott's house, the Fitch house, Fitch Adams house, is significantly more historically significant and public money was used to create that portion.
Yes, we agree.
Okay.
So initially, Mr. Chairman, I guess we're saying we don't have a problem with the concept that's enunciated by that paragraph. I guess the only issue is the restriction going to say anything different than this? And if it's just going to say this, then why do we have that?
Well, it's going to be negotiated by the historic Hopkinton Historic Commission, and they can determine how that goes.
We've been there. We've done that. There's nothing in the bylaw that says we have to go back and negotiate anything with the Historic Commission.
Well, there's nothing in the bylaw that says that we have to permit a special permit. The town is giving you something.
And we're giving you something back. We're happy to. We've already submitted a proposal. And if you guys don't like the language of the restriction, well, I'm happy to work with the planning board.
This is the language that they're suggesting, right?
That's what I don't know whether the board members are supporting that or not.
I think there's a confusion. That's the language you're suggesting for the special permit. That still would require an actual restriction to be crafted, to be attached to the deed of the property.
Correct.
I just want the applicant to be aware of that. I'm not sure that's clear.
This is before the planning board. We have been before the Historical Commission.
I'd entertain a motion to continue this hearing.
So moved.
This doesn't seem like we'll get there today. Moved and seconded. We need to continue it to?
Our next meeting is June 27th.
At what time can we do this?
We have solar at 7:30.
So do it at?
8:30.
No, let's do it at 9:30.
Mr. Chairman?
Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to suggest a discussion. We should vote on this so that we all see whether the planning board, before we continue, vote on just this paragraph, the wording that you added in, and see if we're all...
Well,
Mr. Chairman, I have one request that I think makes sense. Could we be issued a restriction that the planning board would suggest that's suitable? We're not using the Abbott one. We're not using our proposed one. So we're happy to consider something else. But this is a planning board special permit.
Okay. We potentially could do something like that, but we're not going to craft it tonight because we're already over.
I totally understand.
But we're going to ask that the Historic Commission comes in and weighs in on it. Because quite frankly, they're the ones that have the most to say. And, you know, we don't like to regulate historic buildings because that's, quite frankly, their job. So
if we could have something in plenty of time to discuss it, and if the commission...
I'm sorry to interrupt. I don't even know where the board stands as we sit here today. So is that the only thing holding us up, or is there something else beyond that? Do we have agreement that that's the only thing holding us up, or?
I feel a census that with that, there's a board generally approval of splitting it into two lots, except for maybe Frank's feeling a little not so comfortable.
At this point, I would lean toward that, but again.
I think it's subject to whatever we tell them with the restriction. That's where I am, let me put it that way.
I agree.
Okay.
Through the board. Jen, if you could sort of coordinate that with the Historic Commission, that'd be great.
I'll do my best.
Thank you, I know you will.
Do they meet between now and then?
I don't believe they do, but that doesn't mean they can't.
Okay, you're right.
Talk to Mr. Rowe and see if he can get his board together.
Okay, so.
Appreciate your time.
So there's a motion in front of the board to continue this public hearing until?
June 27th at 9:30?
Yeah. All those, and seconded, all those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed, anyone abstained, motion carries.
Thank you all.
Thanks, guys.
Okay, good night, thank you.
Good night, guys.
Okay, now we're running a little later than we should be, but let's try to move along. We're gonna invite the Pulte folks in. Come on in.
Come on down. Do you remember when you guys met with them before? I thought there were some other questions or a list of questions with them once before. No?
That kind of was
the kind of gist of it.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay.
My friend with the big plans, how are you tonight?
Okay.
It's not your fault.
Mark, we're short one member, and he's going to be out permanently.
Okay.
Because Fran has already missed one, so this is the second one. And so, it's obviously, it's your choice whether you want to go ahead. We will not talk about the special permit because he can still vote on that.
Yeah, okay.
So we will continue the special permit to the next
27th
at 8:30. Okay, so I'm going to entertain. First of all, I'm going to open the public hearing for Northeast, Northwest, and North Club Villages at Legacy Farms. This is an application under the Osmond Site Plan Review. And we'll also, at this time, request a motion to continue the amendment to the Legacy Farms Master Plan Special Permit by Pulte Homes, and also the amendment to amend the Master Plan Special Permit for Legacy Farms by Legacy Farms LLC for the age-restricted homes to
8:30
on June 22nd. Do I hear that motion?
So moved.
Do I hear a second? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, say no. Anyone opposed? No. Nobody abstained. Motion carries. So we've taken care of the special permits. We've moved those on out. And we are waiting the peer review of the LNG stuff, and hopefully we'll have it done by that meeting, and then we can maybe talk about particularly the age-restricted stuff at that meeting. That's the key that we'll be looking for on that portion. So now we're talking about the site plan review. We started this out, and we were kind of going at the pace of our three new board members. I think you got through most of your presentation, I think. Was it?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
I think so.
Okay, and let's see. We were going to Jen, are you wanting to do the director's report, or are you waiting on Elaine, who I don't see sitting here?
Correct. I don't have the history that Elaine has with this project, so I'm not up to snuff to do the director's report on this. In your package last time was her slideshow that she had done originally, and then she and I are also at some point going to meet with the new members to do sort of a regulatory overview of the whole Legacy Farms development so they can be brought up to speed a little quicker. As far as the whole project in and of itself. So that's where that stands. Other than that, I don't have a ton to say.
Okay.
So if you'd like her at the next meeting to get a report, I can certainly ask her to attend.
I think that might be a good idea.
Okay.
So let's skip this. And let's get on to an opportunity by the public and the planning board to add to the outline. At this point, we try to organize these site plan reviews by following an outline so that everyone knows what we're prepared for, and we got all the issues there, and we try to talk about those issues at that particular time. Then the board will kind of come to a consensus and move on to the next one, and we find that works pretty well on that. But this is and during this general discussion, we encourage discussion and questions from the public as well as board members. But at this point, we have a fairly large outline. It's a fairly large project. But we might have missed something in our outline. We encourage anyone from the public that wants to add to the outline, or board members, particularly new board members, maybe there was something we needed to talk about here. So, and we will make sure it gets on the outline. This is kind of like a brainstorming. So you can say kind of, we don't want to have to talk about it right now, but we'll fit it into the outline, and we'll talk about it when it makes sense. So does any board members have any additions to the outline that you want to add? Yes.
Mr. Chairman, 4G, lessons learned. I have four bullet items to add. I don't know if you'd like to add them now, or is it just more detail, or do you want to wait till we get there?
4G...
Second page, top of the second page.
Okay, yeah.
Lessons learned.
Okay, go ahead.
The first bullet was more screening was added.
Okay.
The second bullet was roads were converted to cul-de-sacs.
Cul-de-sac.
Number three, curbs on both sides of the street.
Curbs.
And number four, a more detailed construction plan. That's just when I was reviewing, I just pulled those out.
Okay.
Thought they'd be helpful.
Okay, we are probably talking about most of those things somewhere in here, certainly.
Okay.
They're probably mixed in, but it's not bad to kind of get it together. Okay.
Question for the chair?
Yep.
Didn't we have a item for solar energy?
We can add something for solar energy.
All right.
Let's kind of stick that in right at the end of four.
Thank you.
Like I, maybe. Solar. And, okay. Other questions, items in there?
Sure.
Yeah, go.
Use of gray water for any kind of irrigation. It's been brought up, but it hasn't actually been addressed.
Gray water.
All the grass that grows.
Okay. At this point, we're taking any and all. Any ideas?
I have one for the, just in the wording, snow removal. Of when?
Okay.
Instead of if?
Snow removal.
I also have another just a question in regards the proposed cluster village construction presents a considerable exposure hazard from building to building if fire conditions were present. However, that looks going forward due to the number of inspections. And the need to be involved in second and third incident operations response.
You're talking the fire chief's comments?
Yes.
I think we got that under safety as a broad item, but we will certainly we'll expand that to make sure we these are retired Chief Clark's comments. We will make sure we talk about that.
Well, to that point, the density of the project has changed since that letter.
Yes.
They've moved it in.
Closer. Proximity.
To increase more open space.
Yep.
One of the requirements we did on the south side, which will be done here, I believe, is a requirement to sprinkle all the houses.
Right.
That took care of Chief Clark's most significant concerns on, I'll say, the density of the structure. There's still about 20 feet between units, if I...
That's a good average, yeah.
Yeah. But we will talk about that more so as we get in there, because those are...
Was that done on the south?
That was on the south side. Every unit on the south side, except for the single-family homes, is fully sprinkled. And the sprinkling, if I remember correctly, it's the type of sprinkling that gives you enough time to get out of the building, but not necessarily enough time to save the structure. And I'm not sure I'm enough of a plumber to understand the difference of that, but I think it's the amount of water that comes squirting out of the sprinkler heads. But anyway, we will talk a lot more about that, because that is a condition that I'm sure we'll be interested in. Okay, I'm not seeing anyone else. Okay, oh, go ahead.
I have a very specific traffic question. I'm not sure if this is something you want to ask.
Name and address.
Julia Linnell, 5 Reservoir Road.
Okay, and state your question, and then we'll figure out where it fits.
On your traffic study online, it talks about the turn from Legacy Farm Road going west. That intersection of Wilson and Legacy Farm Road.
Wilson and Legacy.
Yeah.
Okay.
And it's a little vague, and it addresses one way. It doesn't really address both.
Okay. Ways. We'll add that Wilson Legacy North.
And in the neighborhood that's sort of locked in down there, so.
Yep.
It's a concern.
Okay, we will address that one. A lot of that was done on when we did the subdivision plan that created Legacy North. But as under site plan, we can always relook at the traffic studies and address the concern.
So maybe we'll do this and we'll look at it later.
Yep. Okay, that's another good one. Okay, I'm not seeing any more, so let's say that we've done with number three. And now we're going to start the general discussion, and we're starting off with trails. And there is also a letter that we got today that I think you guys have put together that kind of helps us get through some of these.
Yeah, essentially the letter was, we took your outline, and what we wanted to do is just put written responses to the outline just to help with the conversations that we have. Obviously, much of this was presented previously, but I think it helps just to put it in written form to help you as you go through the project.
That can help guide discussion. Distributed Friday.
Yeah, unfortunately, none of us got to see it on Friday because
the package. I left the office.
The packages go out on Thursday. I mean, we got an email, so we're going to kind of read along with it. But we encourage you to get all your submittals in at the absolute minimum by close of business
Tuesday,
on
Tuesday, right?
Tuesday at 5 is the deadline now.
So it certainly helps because. Quite frankly, I would have rather read all this on Tuesday than today. I mean, over the weekend. Okay, but having said that, we can kind of continue on with the trail. So for the new members, we got through this one the last time around, and we kind of said that we had a trail map that we were on the north parcel, which is not part of this, but interfaces with this a lot. The trails kind of intersect with all this type of property, and I think we found the that from a trail standpoint, that we met all the trail connections for that were in the proposed preliminary master plan special permit requirements. I think we also decided, and we're not going to talk about the north parcel as part of this, but I assure you that we, because that was one of the submittals that was triggered by this submittal going on, that we will talk about the north parcel in great detail as to how we're going to get that finished off and trails and roadways and a bunch of other stuff that goes on that. And about half of us went on the site walk a couple Saturdays ago, and we did get up into that north parcel for a while. And we, but we will spend some more time on that probably after we get this one permitted. But I think the importance from this discussion, and I'm trying to speed it along a little bit, that the last discussion we kind of said that we looked at trails on the south side after we did all the buildings, and we purposely put trails first thing because we wanted to make sure they didn't get disconnected on the north side. Like the south side, we sub-optimized trails. Brian?
Mr. Chair, to that point, I just have one quick question. I'm looking at some of these trails going through the north parcel on the westerly side. I know there's plans for future development in that area. How will that break, you know, do we have any ideas how that could break up these trail systems?
I think, and it's hard to tell exactly, but I think the far westerly one, which is kind of connects from west, from, I think that one will probably be in a open space area that is okay. I'm not sure that the eastern one, the trail looks like it goes through the buffer zone on the wetlands, and we have not seen things for the 180 units, but if it's in the buffer zone for the wetlands, I doubt that they'll be building in those areas. Roy?
Mr. Chairman, I think the most western trail, I think we're going to find when we look at the circles,
yep,
it's probably going to be outside the zone. So I think that trail is fine. And I think you're absolutely right. I think these trails will actually be right on the border of the wetlands, so they'll be outside of the building zone. So I actually think where they are, it's going to work out pretty well.
Terrific. Thank you.
Okay. Other other part, we talked about the trail parking, and we kind of came up with a couple of spots along Legacy Farms Road North as trail parking. We also came up with trail parking up on the north parcel, up on, I'll say, Curve Road, I guess it would be, up near the corner of the LNG facility. We also, when we were on the site walk, for those members that weren't there, we looked at the intersections with Legacy Farms Road North. And some of us had a concern, I think, during that first presentation that if moms are parking, waiting for the bus, that maybe at those three intersections there isn't quite enough parking. And one of the suggestions was that maybe some of the parking could be done at the trail parking, which would be across the street, maybe not quite as desirable, but it would get your car off the road. And I think three of the four connections, or a couple more of the connections had room without going into the wetland buffers to create some more parking over on the other side. Some of them were already located at that spot. And we didn't discuss it as a item because you don't do that on a site walk, but that might be something from a trail parking. It seemed to be obvious from those people that were walking that might make the solution to the other problem more tenable. And I think you guys were going to look at that after.
Right. We have looked at some locations across the street from the developed areas, and physically, horizontally, it looks like there's room to do those. The question becomes one of grading. There are some steep drops from Legacy Farms Road off the side of the road, so there'd be some fill that would be required to raise those areas up to a level where you could park off them. So we're studying that. We need to talk with Roy about it some more, but it looks like we may be able to do that. We're exploring that right now.
Okay.
Through the chair?
Yeah.
Would that be inclusive of size accommodation as well? Could you vary the size of that fill to expand it a little bit? Would that be a feasible thing?
To expand.
Seeing as how you're going to create that area with fill, mm-hmm. could you make that a little bit bigger than what is perceived as a three or four place parking area?
Yeah, we've looked at a number of different locations, you know, trying to line them up across the intersection of the Legacy Farms Road entry and doing, you know, 4 to 6 space areas at each of those locations. The alternative would be, as you say, to have fewer locations but more parking spaces in those locations.
Correct.
So pick 3 out of the 6 locations and expand that parking, and that may actually be a better way to go. That's what we're looking at right now.
Yeah, so to the end of that, mm-hmm. being that instead of keeping them as a 4 to 6 spot, let's say,
right,
and you made it a 6 to 8 spot, because you're still making the size whatever it's going to be anyway, because you're going to have to do backfill,
yeah,
in order to create. So why not create just a little bit more, which gives you more room for anything else that, like Ken Chair says about parking in the morning to keep people off the road and of that nature.
Right.
Yeah.
Yep.
I think, and maybe my memory is that the prior board was okay with it from a trails parking standpoint, because we will also have trail parking, you know, off a curved street up at the top, which, and then if the athletic parcel gets developed, there'll be plenty of parking in that particular area, which I think will be maybe as good or better places. These will be good parking places because people going along Legacy North will know about it. The curved street one off of Wilson Street will be Hopkins' little secret, I guess. And it'll also be for those that are less physically active, because there's other comments on parking for trails or and then the last one we kind of already touched on it, coordination with the master plan special permit trail overview. Anyone else have any comments on trails, questions on trails? John?
The chair. Open space didn't have a quorum when we reviewed it, but was supportive of the parking proposed.
The parking, okay.
What was that? I'm sorry?
We didn't have a quorum at the meeting, but those who were attending the meeting were supportive of the quantity of the spaces and the location at the time of the proposed parking.
Okay. So if we get a few more spots for other reasons, I think that makes it sufficient for this, and I think we have consensus on the trail overview at this point and the trail connections that were through there. So then the next item was on landscaping. I think try to summarize this a little bit. From a landscaping on and existing mature trees, we're kind of preserving 1 or 2 groves within the entire buildable site of 189 acres. And that's about it. Everything else is clear cut. And there's a couple of beautiful maple trees that are right in the middle of the roadway, which unfortunately they are. That kind of was the conclusion on the sidewalk. A lot of the trees are not, they're leftovers and what couldn't be sold at the nursery, I think, is maybe the best way to care. Well, some of them we could probably get used in the landscaping plans, the better ones. But
actually, there's quite a few we can use in the landscaping plans.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman?
Yep.
Just a question about the statement, Legacy Farms provides 500 acres of permanent protected open space. And looking at Jen's document, it says 367 acres.
By the time they get done, it ends up, we kind of have a rolling amount on it, but at the end of the day, we're going to get there.
Okay. I'm good with that.
Or we don't approve the next development, you know. I mean, at the end of the day, we'll make sure that 500 is there.
That's right.
We track that very fastidiously, and there's still large portions that we have not restricted yet, so we have a running tally, and we will get just slightly north of 500 acres.
Thank you.
But not significantly north.
Because otherwise, they'd be very afraid of what the chairman would say.
Okay, and I think let's talk about landscaping details for the back of units facing Legacy Farms Road North. I believe that was handled pretty well in the presentation that you guys did in your opening portion. Are there other questions from the audience members on this one? Questions from the planning board members. I believe the details are the berm and a bunch of more planning, and that certainly was a lesson learned on the south side because the original plans didn't have at all what's even currently on the south side, and you know, the south side looks a lot better than what I guess the plans, well, when we built it to the plans, it didn't.
Through the board?
Yeah,
go ahead. Through the chair. We did, on our walk, recognize the berms that were presently established, and they look good as far as blocking view. So I think you guys are right on track with that. There's not much more that we could ask of you to facilitate that. Being said, just do your best.
Very good. Thanks, yeah. Cliff. Thank you.
We've put a lot of effort into those berms.
You have.
Well, I think it'll help you sell houses too, quite frankly.
Right.
I mean, you got the roadway that's going 35 miles an hour, and if it's in my short backyard, I'd prefer to have berms and some trees there to kind of block them off. Right?
Just, you know, I mean, to piggyback on what Cliff said, you know, I mean, first, the landscape of the north parcel really gives itself to a lot of hiding of the homes from the street. But the plan, the landscaping plan with the trees and the berms, I think really helps a lot, even more so than the landscape, and I think you guys have done a great job with that. I look forward to it. I think it's going to be a completely different look from the south side.
You've done wonderful job.
Thank you.
Speaking about landscaping.
Yeah, but you've got to remember, the Pulte construction guy sat right here and told us, he said, you know, landscaping for real never looks as good as what it did on paper.
Right, right.
And I'll tell you, that was, I almost fell off my chair that time, but so anyway.
We got it, yeah. Yeah.
Right.
You know, I would say it's probably true in the early stages of the south side, but once those plans were approved, and we all saw that, frankly, it wasn't sufficient landscaping, you must have added 300 or 400 trees,
yep.
Immense amount of trees. And the amount of trees that's going in the north side is even more immense than what's in the south side have to be augmented. So I think it's a significantly improved plan.
So that kind of was one of my questions. I was asked that, I have a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
I was asked if we're doing such great stuff, which I think the planning on the north side we have learned from the south, but people said, well, south side is still being under construction. Why can't we improve the south side? And I think I've asked this before, and I forget what the exact answer was, but Roy mentioned that you are putting additional trees on the south side, but there's things like there's a swing set just hanging out in someone's backyard and half in the edge of the wetland, I mean, on the south side. I mean, is there anything that can be done through this side of the project to help the south side of the project?
If I could pick up on that, the nice thing about the north side of it, there are no single-family homes on the north side, so everything is under a landowners association and a homeowners association. On the south side, there are 15 single-family homes, and they are not bound by the HOA or the LOA.
I think
what you're referring to is a home that's a single-family home.
Maybe.
Next time you go through, make a note of that, because it probably is. But anyway, the other thing is on the south side, Frank, there was a bunch of trees that are in the subdivision plan that got taken down, and I would assume that they're going to be put back up. So, yeah, there'll probably be some plantings before Legacy South Road gets accepted.
Thank you. And thank you, Roy.
Okay. Other things on landscaping. Okay. Restricted parcels. Let's move on to that. I think we're kind of getting into a little bit, and it ties to the special permit discussion, but so maybe we should defer that until we talk more about that.
Probably a good idea.
I think one of the things that we need to do, though, is to craft the wording for the, is it the resident? What was the new, the type of restricted, the private open space? So that could be an action item that gets going forward, because we haven't approved one of those by form. And if you're going to use it, we need to approve it. So we will defer on the locations. Let's defer the item on one, but let's talk a little bit about restoration conditions and removal of plant and soil area. We've got, what, three restricted types that we're going to go on this parcel. One is the private open space, mm-hmm. and that is the small little slivers in between clusters of buildings and the tot lot and a few other things like that. And I don't know whether I'm going to speak for myself, but maybe it's the consensus of the board, we'll get there. That property is to be fully landscaped and integrated in. It's within the building areas. I don't see a lot of restrictions that should be on in that area. The other one is open space that is to be what's the restored, I guess, is the word.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I think one of the lessons learned on restored landscaping conditions is restored, to me, does not remove all the topsoil in the area and only put back 2 or 3 inches or a couple inches. Restored, to me, is more like an additive type portion as opposed to rip it all up, scramble it around, and sell off or use some of the topsoil that, you know, is there. I think everything that's there should remain. Restoration, to me, is you fill in the holes, you take out the asphalts, you take out the debris that might be left over from the nursery operations, and if you want to, plant some trees and stuff like that, but it's more additive than negative. And I don't know where people feel on that.
I agree with that.
Okay, I'm seeing consensus on that. Then the other one is just open space in its natural area. And for those, I think there's a clause that allows us to remove, I'm going to call it debris, and make it safe. But basically, it's to be left as it is. And if I remember correctly, there's something in the construction management, and I think it'll need to get strengthened to maybe put a fence around those lines so that it is left that way. I think towards the end of the south side, their fences started going along where those demarkings are. But that's kind of what...
Mr. Chairman, would those be temporary fencing or permanent fencing?
Temporary fencing, okay. Just to keep the bulldozers out of that area and define it differently.
The fencing is a fine idea, Mr. Chairman.
And basically, certainly in the leaving a natural space, we're not expecting any soil to leave any of those areas, as is the restored stuff. I mean, a lot of this nursery area, most of the soil is left in the form of root balls over the years. I mean, I have some of that soil in my front yard.
If I may,
Cliff.
Going back just a few sentences of Ken's, was that when we take the existing hardtop and mulch it in, maybe we add some soil over that in conjunction with the turning of it the way that... Go ahead, Ken.
Well, Mr. Chairman, I think the last time we discussed this, where there are currently called roads, some of them are gravel roads, some of them are paved roads, partially paved, etc. So I think at the appropriate time, it may very well be once construction starts, we should decide where, or at least agree, either the road's going to stay as a road, which most likely most won't, but we can pulverize paved roads and turn it into a gravel walkway, if you will. And there are other areas where it's just dirt, we might just decide to bring it along and seed it over. So I think those are the options. I don't think you necessarily decide in advance of what that would be, but I think we should have a criteria for option A, B, and C.
We're going to need to figure out somewhere in that area, and we probably ought to look at where the buildable areas are within this permit sooner than that, I think. Maybe you guys can put together a... I mean, you have the satellite view of the nurseries, and you know mm-hmm. which roads are in those categories, and let's quickly talk about it, make a recommendation of which ones... What gets done what to those areas in the category of restored
and preservation
and left it natural?
You put together
I have that plan, but I'm actually not referring to the buildable areas. Because the buildable areas, by the time you get down, there are going to be no paved roads.
Right.
The area I'm referring to is the 100 acres that we restricted very early on, but the 68 acres, I guess.
Do you want that map up? The area?
It's the piece directly behind the LNG facility.
Well, we'll talk about the north parcel separately. After that's not part of this permit.
Is this what you're...
Yeah.
That's all, we're not talking about
this. If you can, do you have the map that shows all the little restricted parcels? It had the three or four different colors.
That's what I was looking
for. This is the one?
Yeah. No, you just missed it, I think.
Ken, you're concerned with the slivers and stuff like that. You want to see how it's all driving out restricted land.
Well,
right there.
Is this the restriction? Like, for example, you've got, if you go up around the north east village there,
yeah.
Put your marker down right there.
Mm-hmm.
That is restricted land left in its natural state?
Natural, yes.
Okay.
Correct.
No, but there's a basin there.
There is a what?
There's a stormwater basin there. They're done.
Yeah, that will all be shown on the...
But what Ken's asking...
What I'm saying is if you look at the parts that are part of the property that you guys are buying from Mr. McDowell,
mm-hmm.
that's in the restricted land, we want you to kind of recommend what you're going to do with all the roadways that are there. You know, are you going to pulverize and remove it? You know...
We can do that.
Because that's part of your permit. So...
We can actually look at the overlay we have done and come back to you with all those comments.
Mr. Chairman.
And will we see a map of that?
That's what I'm asking for, yeah, a map, and maybe you, you identify the grid some way with the letter, and you have a table that says Nursery Road A, remove Nursery Road B,
with
reseed.
Well,
stormwater item will trump whatever. I mean, that's
right.
That's kind of, in many ways, a buildable feature. I mean, you
correct.
Know, it's, I mean, that stormwater trumps it anyway, because you're
we have to have that.
Well, you're gonna use a bulldozer to create it.
Right.
I mean, so the roadway is gone. I'm not worried about that one, but it's the roadway that might be starting at the other side of the stormwater.
Mr. Chairman?
Yeah.
I can't imagine that we'll have a lot of pulverized areas. Most of them, I would think, would be remove and reseed. But do you know what the planning board suggests or the trails committee suggests for the trails?
Well, what they should do is, if there's a trail that's going to go into that, through that restricted area, you ought to show
fix
that on the map.
One
and, you know,
no, but what should be the surface for that? Should this pulverize, is that an acceptable surface?
Well, we've been, the criteria we've been using can either be a grass trail, a natural as-is trail, or if we have existing gravel, a gravel trail. So it's a combination. We have some trails on the south side and nothing more than one path going through the woods.
My concern was that if we're going to be pulverizing one area and we want to pull it out of there, that if it's a valid option for trails, we can make some of our trails also be that.
I think it's a good way to reuse material and not have to truck it off-site. And I guess most of that stuff would have to go off-site unless it's used as road base, because I don't think you can use that as fill around foundations or anything like that. So it might be easier to get rid of it.
Environmentally conscientious.
Through the chair, I thought they wanted to use horses on those trails.
True, yeah.
Well, I don't think that would work well with horses.
Well, the pulverized should be okay.
Pulverized is kind of like gravel, isn't
yeah.
it?
Yeah. But it's a good point,
I just
Vinny.
Don't think they like gravel.
But that harkens to my, through the chair,
yeah.
That harkens to my point about if it is pulverized and it is not sufficiently graded to where horses, people, that you add a topsoil over that on just the trails that are active. Do you see what I'm saying?
No, I do, but I think you're going to find some areas lend themselves more to a gravel trail.
Yeah.
And other areas, for instance, if it's going for a meadow,
yeah.
That probably wants to be a grass trail and low.
Absolutely.
I'll give you an example. Take the trail that goes behind the LNG facility.
Mm-hmm.
That for sure wants to be a gravel. It's going to be actually a little extra wide because the gas company has a tendency to drive their vehicles and check their perimeter, if you will. So you don't want that to be grass. You want that to be
mm-hmm. Very good.
Okay.
Through the chair.
Yeah.
I believe Jane Moran from the Upper Charles Trail Committee was here last meeting, and we had this discussion with
she took our walk with us.
Okay.
We actually walked with her.
Where we left off was how you had stated it, Roy, with the various approaches to the trails.
She was fine with that.
That's what I believe.
Yeah,
I mean.
Yeah, well, she was very happy with the outcome.
We're doing it in the context of restricted land. What do we expect to be done with those pieces of parcels?
Right.
That's sure. We want to define it so at the end of the day, we know they're done.
That's good.
We'll have a plan for it.
Okay. Okay, let's see, where are we going? We've got some time yet. Let's go on.
Design.
Anyone else have anything else on restricted land? And we are deferring the locations. Okay. Design architecture. Let's see. Basically, we kind of talked about a bunch of this stuff before.
Mr. Chairman, if I may?
Why don't you guys present your deal?
Sure. A couple things. We ran through a lot of that in our presentation at the last planning board hearing. And we started out by saying that we had discussed it at length with the design review board through a series of meetings with them ultimately culminating in their recommendation for approval of the architecture. We discussed having seven different floor plans for each of the types of units, resulting in a myriad variations on how these can be assembled. We've provided some language that references a memo we'd previously sent to the Design Review Board with some of the commitments that we'd made in terms of how we would vary that up within the neighborhoods. And that's attached in this outline that we provided last week. If you'd like to see any of the architecture in greater detail, we do have boards for that, but I think we did go through quite a bit of that at the last hearing.
I don't think...
Is there anyone here from the public that wants to see the architectural boards? Or any member of the planning boards wants to go through that? Okay, we've received that as a submittal, so we have it. Basically, in your memo, and without Jen here, but I believe last time on the south side we had a condition that talked about combinations and all the things that were agreed to on the south side, and I'm assuming that. The fact
you've made that same commitment.
You made that same commitment in here, and the variation of architecture, as put in their memo, will end up being a condition that will go forward on there.
In the memo that we submitted to the Design Review Board and also copied to the Planning Board, there was a number of commitments that we made in order to satisfy the Design Review Board, and those are listed in the memo, and certainly would make a nice list of conditions. For a future document.
Yeah. Go ahead, Cliff.
Like I had mentioned in our last meeting, and your presentation was very well presented. How do you police that type of differentiation of structure and offsets? Mm-hmm. Like you, as the builders, would. You know, I'm sure you're limited to the client to only a certain amount of facial structures or something. Is that
well? We just set up internal controls. So if homeowner A comes in and they purchase a certain home and a certain elevation and a certain color and a certain design, then all of the homes directly across the street or directly next to it on either side. When the homeowner B comes in, the sales folks have a running controls in order to make sure that they know that
it's limited.
That it's not available for sale. They have to choose a different color, they have to choose a different elevation, or they have to choose a different housing style in order to comply with this condition that we drafted in order to
and I reiterated sure that just for the public and for our board.
Yeah.
As state of fact.
Yeah.
Okay.
I had a couple questions on what we had here. The garage doors and the garage doors with window, you have two, not every garage door is going to have the X's on it.
Right. So one of the, Mr. Chairman,
yep.
So one of the updates that we made to the architecture was when we first submitted our plans, it had all of the same garage door throughout mm-hmm. all of the homes. So what we've done is, we have two different types of garage doors that will be intermingled between all the different homes types. So it'll add variety to the street as you drive down the street. And then in addition to the two doors, we've also made a commitment to have 20% of the homes have garage windows. So in each of the door styles will have the optional windows. So in essence, you have four different varying styles of garage doors that you'll see as you drive, as you weave down the
and
streets.
Each neighborhood, I guess, won't have, is not defined by its type of garage door. It can be,
there'll be a door.
All
it's
you know,
not
garage doors are intermittent. Right. That's not part
that's
of
not
your
part of the neighborhood identity package,
right.
So
which you had mentioned.
Right. Okay. That's more landscape and site furnishings and lighting.
I think the overall theme is we wanted to give the architecture as much variety as possible, but we wanted to give the neighborhood landscaping and themes a consistent theme between the neighborhoods. So it's kind of the way we set it up.
Mm-hmm. I'll tell you, one of the items that I'm not crazy about, I mentioned it on the south side, is when you don't put at least a prime coat on the inside of the garage doors and they're open, they all look unfinished when you go down the road and on a Saturday morning when everyone's bicycle is out there. You know, I mean, it's, I saw that when we visited your place up in wherever it was, Concord or whatever.
Was it Bedford that you went
maybe to? It was Bedford. And it just, to me, spray coat in the garage just makes it look a lot finished because most of your folks aren't going to paint the inside of your garage. And I'm not saying you do much of it, but I'll tell you, to me, that always, my garage looks like hell, but I mean, you can't see the walls because it's full of crap. But it's, these folks are not usually coming in with as much stuff as I have accumulated, I guess. There was more questions?
I just had a question about the garage doors. So the applicant is now proposing two different garage door styles to be used throughout the villages. Is that throughout two styles within each village or two throughout the whole north parcel? Yeah. Two styles.
It'll be within each of the villages. So it's the northeast village will not have all the same garage door.
There'll be two styles within the northeast village.
Yeah, they're going to be interdispersed.
Two different styles within the north club. Or
do you want to show the two different garage door styles?
Sure.
Is it a total of two styles? Or
total of two styles.
Two styles.
That's for legacy.
That's what I want to know. If it was just two styles, or if we're looking at now.
Two per style.
No. Two styles.
Two for this village, two for this village, two for that village.
Yeah. No, just two just styles.
That's fine.
Yes.
I've seen the renderings.
Okay. So one of the styles is this with the cross bracing. Right. What you see here? And then one of the variations is having the windows in the upper portion. And then the other style of garage door is more of the sort of board on board.
It has the decorative hardware, which is the
chunkier black hardware that accents, sort of looks like hinges on a big barn door.
I mean, I think the only reason we care about garage doors on something like this is when you really look at the house, that's half of the facade.
So the other thing that we're proposing to do is to paint the garage doors the same color as the body of the siding, so they don't jump out to you. I think on the south we painted the bucks white and the body of the door the color of the siding, and this time we're going to paint the whole door so that it's not doesn't just jump out at you. It's, it more blends in with the home.
Do you want to go somewhere with that?
No, I was just curious if we were looking at two styles or if we were looking at style.
Well, I think you're looking at four with the windows.
Right.
Four variations, I guess. One of the things that I noticed we did on the south side where there are some townhouses that you were able to rotate the garage on when it was on a corner.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't see any of those that were on the plans on this side.
One of the specific design criteria that Matt used when he was doing his landscape site planning is all of the intersections, we've located the garage door on the other side of the intersection so that you see the non-garage door side of the home, which tends to have more windows and more architecture of variety. That was definitely something that we've focused on when we were doing the land planning.
Okay. Can I explain that a little bit better?
Yeah, let me point to a plan. Describe what we're referring to here.
That's perfect.
Yeah. So as you're driving up Road C, for example, you're not looking at the garage side of this first house. You're looking at the window side where the living space is
in the front door.
And that happens at all of the intersections. If you're looking at this house from the side, the garage isn't here, lined up with the intersection. It's inboard, and the more detailed side of the house faces out towards the intersection. So at every intersection, we have that condition where the garage side is located away from the intersection where it'll be most of the... Does that make more sense?
Is that a specific house style, or is that just flipping the garage?
No, that's just making sure the house is rotated in the right direction so that you're not seeing the sort of the broad side of the garage elevation from any intersection.
We had a couple on the south side that variety, I guess, rotated it around, but maybe, I don't know. It added variety, but it, maybe it didn't aesthetically wasn't as pleasing. As, I don't know. That's a judgment call, I guess. I'm not sensing a...
I'll notice more next time I drive through.
you won't until they stop.
You'll see it on the south side.
Yes.
A few of the corners where the garage is one way. Mm-hmm. I guess I'll look at it again that way. But I think we were trying to vary the what you see, but maybe we varied it by making it maybe not as attractive, as I guess is what...
Overthought it.
Okay. Going on the design, I think we've hit the variation. We've talked about the siding, I think, for minimizing rows of garages. Do the new members, back to the simplex duplex townhouses, were you part of that discussion at all? Or do you need more?
I don't remember I remember us talking about simplexes and duplexes, but the townhouses I don't particularly remember. Is there something that I missed?
Probably not. I mean, one of the items with the townhouse, which goes back to the original master plan special permit, the townhouses use up less land, so because there isn't 20 feet between, you know, a bunch of units. On the other hand, everyone will tell you that the inside units of a townhouse don't sell. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we've had a fairly successful sales track record with what we've designed on the south side from a product mix. I'm not sure we want to tackle that, but that was put with the outline where if we ran out of space, you can go back to
the townhouse.
You can go back, and not all of them or anything like that, but that you know, if at the end of the day you get to the point where you feel that they're just too close to trail, too close to this, if you need to create space, a townhouse creates 20 feet per unit. You combine, actually more than that, it creates about 40.
Ken, you bring up a very good point in that the market demand really is for the simplex / duplex. And if you have a third unit in the middle, not only is it less desirable, but from a sales point of view, which extrapolates to a property tax point of view for the town, is significantly less. You're probably looking at at least $100,000 less per unit. So when you look at it from a tax point of view, and frankly, just the sheer massing from an aesthetic point of view, that's a building that long. I think that visual breaks, whether it be the simplex or the duplex, makes sense, I think, for the site.
And for the town of Hopkinton.
And for the town of Hopkinton, yeah.
So, Mr. Chairman, looking at Chen's numbers, it looks like there's a couple hundred simplexes and 224 multifamily attached. So I guess we don't want the breakdown of the town. But they're mostly duplexes, the multifamilies. Is that what I'm hearing?
The multifamily are duplexes.
They're all multifamily homes under a condominium, but 201 are detached condominium homes, and then 224 are duplex condominium homes. So it's about a, you know, pretty even mix of the two. And as far as space, as part of the revised plan that we submitted, one of the things that Matt did was he varied the architecture and the home styles in certain locations in order to include some of the tot lot, the green spaces that we've added, in order to add the space between the trails, in order to add different buffers, and incorporate all of Beta's comments that they had in their review letter. So. You know, we're comfortable with the amount of green space and the amount of space that on the plan. I think it's much improved.
Is there a map that says what style goes in what spot?
There is not. What there is there are the boxes on the plan are big enough in a majority of locations to incorporate all of the different home styles that we propose, so that if a homeowner comes in and they want to choose a certain home type, we know that these locations can handle that home style. So what we did was, on the original plan, we had all of the biggest boxes on the site. And then on the revised plan, in order to incorporate and address all the comments that the design review board and beta and the board had,
yeah, and some of the pocket parks and additional open spaces,
where we shrunk up the homes, and now they don't incorporate some of the biggest homes. They incorporate maybe the third biggest homes and down. And our salespeople will have a lot fit matrix, and they'll know at those locations, you know, you can't sell the A model, you only can sell the C, D, and E model.
What happens on a duplex? First guy there gets to pick the style? First guy with the money down?
Yes. So we build the duplex all at once.
Yeah.
So, and the duplexes fit together. You know, they architecturally, design-wise, have to a certain product go to a certain product at certain. The first one is picked, and then the second one is built as a spec, and hopefully is sold, you know, very quickly.
Very quickly.
Sorry, Mr. Chairman, I just want to make sure I wasn't clear about the answer. So there are no, they're all duplexes, no homes with three.
There are no homes.
Correct.
No.
So basically, they're all two bedrooms?
No, there's a mix. So all of the duplexes are two bedrooms.
Right, that's what I was asking.
And then the detached simplexes, some are two bedrooms and some are three
bedrooms.
So they
basically have three choices. A two-bedroom duplex,
two-bedroom
simplex, or a three-bedroom simplex.
Correct. And then each of the duplexes and each of the simplexes has another, you know, 50 different, there's eight different.
Oh, yeah, I'm duplex, sure. Yeah. As far as the number of bedrooms and the number of units.
It's a big choice.
Yeah, big choice.
And some of them have bedrooms on the first floor?
Yeah.
Correct.
Yeah.
Yep, some.
So.
We feel we have a home for all of the different buyers. In order to have this many homes and to be able to be successful and sell a number of homes a year so that you can actually complete a job of the style, you need to have a variety of different products that will match a variety of different buyers, and that's what we're trying to bring to market.
So
what's been more successful on the south side, simplexes or duplexes? Or are you pretty well?
I think they've both been equally as successful, but so the duplex.
So your allocation between the villages and the south side is working out pretty good.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, if I may, I mean, I think the your statement is correct. The allocation is working out well, and also it tends to change. So there's a kind of an ebb and flow of what becomes popular by different buyers. I wish we could predict that, but. You know, we don't really have that crystal ball, but we try our best looking at what we hear from customers who come in, and then looking at how their actions speak when they actually buy. And then we try to pick the essence of those choices, and that's on the south side, the folks we've been working with. And then we came up with the new designs here on the north side. They're all new and different, and we're trying to appeal to different buyers, but just as varied. So that was part of our goal. So I think the simplex duplex mix that we chose allows for this variety of different floor plans, different locations, and then different price points. And obviously price points are very important for folks. So I think we've got a good framework for a successful project.
So, Mr. Chairman, just one final note to clarify Mr. Kistner's question about townhouses. So, there are, to their point, there are no townhouses in this development.
That's correct.
Okay.
So, on the paper that we're looking at in question, we don't, you know, on our cheat sheet here, should townhouses be included? We can negate.
We're coming to a consensus that no, not needed.
The answer is no.
Okay.
Any other comments from the public on design and architecture? And everyone's ready to put your money down and buy a couple of these beautiful new homes. Okay. We've got about 15 minutes left. And why don't we introduce I think, the construction management plan. And we'll kind of go through some of these things here. It'll be an introduction.
Sure.
And then we'll spend time at the beginning of maybe the the next meeting of getting, making sure we have everyone has the latest and greatest construction management plan, and we'll run through that because I think that's a key item to make sure that we have the wording done on that correctly, and some of that construction management plan will take be instead of a whole pages of conditions, because one of the conditions will be you will follow the construction management plan or we'll stop work. And that'll take care of a lot of the conditions. Okay, so let's kind of go through here, because we'd kind of gotten through a little bit of this for that, but so this is more for the new members of the board, and but also to, because a lot of us are now, I'll say, smarter than we were after doing sidewalks, et cetera. So,
Should I just reintroduce that topic?
Why don't you run right through it? You've got about 12 minutes to kind of do that.
Okay. No pressure.
Well, I'm only going to need six, so that's perfect.
Okay.
So we discussed before the newly elected members were on board putting together a construction management plan that would basically outline what Pulte was going to commit to during the construction phase of the project, once permitting was done and it's time to actually build what we're talking about here. So we submitted a draft construction management plan back in April, which was submitted to the board, reviewed by Beta, and it went through things such as erosion control and stabilization measures that we would undertake during construction, how we'd handle dust control, what the sequencing of construction would be, when we would take down different particular parcels and begin construction on those, where we would store materials during those phases of construction, and then how we would handle operations, where we would have construction vehicles able to drive, where they would be loading, unloading, etc. We provided that construction management plan. As I said, we received some comments from the peer reviewer, from Beta. We've actually responded to those comments and reissued the construction management plan as of May 19th. So that's the document that you now have, Jennifer, I believe, is in your possession. And it's a pretty thick document. It's this.
I think you received it. Came after your package that was sent out last time, so it was another one of those emails.
Let's make sure we all get it in our package next time.
Make sure you get a copy.
So some of the highlights are we provide a graphic within that construction management plan outlining what our proposed sequencing is for construction and when we intend to start those, and when those construction seasons would be.
Mr. Chairman, could you just do 1, 2, 3, 4 just for a benefit?
Absolutely.
Right now?
So we would be beginning with the, and I have a larger map.
Why don't you do the larger one?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. See, I'm going to use up another one of your minutes, and now you're at 7.
How am I doing?
You're doing fine.
All right.
Okay, so sequence A1 would be the red area that you see here, the Northeast Village as it's been called, and then we would proceed to A2 here, which would be about a 33-month construction sequence. Then we'd be looking at the Northwest Village as sequence B, and then the North Club Village as sequence C.
The problem that I have with this is even when you're doing the first red one, you're hauling stuff to the northwest, and
that's not our proposal. We've based on, sorry to interrupt.
Yeah, go ahead.
But based on the concerns that the board has brought up and lessons learned from the South and knowing that this is a huge issue for the board, what we're actually proposing is building the red area as phase one and really confining ourselves to that initial limit of work of tree clear and work zone and starting the construction there and building I'll say half or some of that area, a majority of that area, until we run out of room or until we're ready to move on to the next phase, and then we would move over and we would then work in the orange area as sequence two, and we would do the clear limit clearing in that area. We'd be finishing up sequence one, we'd be working in sequence two, and then as sequence two is getting built out and we need to start building more roads to get ready for more homes, we would then move down to the Northwest Village, which is sequence three, and start building those roads and clearing that area as we finished building the sequence two. And in order, and to get from sequence two to sequence three, we've proposed the Hall Road, so there's a singular crossing of Legacy Farms Road North, which it really addresses some of the construction traffic concerns that we've talked about. So there's a really defined sequence here, and I can't. But what I'm not saying is we're going to build the red sequence one, and it's going to be 100% complete, and then we're going to move on. It's
transitional.
It's transitional. Yes, but the goal is not to open up the whole site at once. We've really
but with the red, I believe you have excess fill. You're not gonna load it in the truck and store it in the red area, and then pick it up again and load it and then haul it across on the Hall Road, are you?
So, Mr. Chairman, so the red area is fairly balanced.
Okay.
We can build the red area on its own, and each of these sequences, there's another exhibit which shows stockpile staging areas in each of the zones. So what we've done is we've really thought this through, and in each of the sequences, we've located these stockpile staging areas where we will utilize and put piles of topsoil and different types of material until that they're needed to use.
Could you create this map in sequences so that if I'm at sequence one, I know what stockpile is going to be used, and that what on sequence two as you're moving through it? Mm. Because, you know.
Right, so during sequence one, this is the stockpile.
And that's the only one that's going to be doing.
There might be a number of piles in that area, but that's a pretty large area. Those are the last homes we're expecting to build in that sequence. Sure. So that's why we've chosen that area to kind of block off.
I'm okay with potentially where you're putting it.
Yeah.
I just want to know with what sequence, how many stockpiles are active. You got, you know, is the stockpile going to be going at all, you know, villages? I want to know the sequence of the, as you
Chairman,
move through.
I think they're all self-contained is what they're saying.
Yeah.
So
well, I don't...
that's what I'm hearing.
I thought when we had cuts and fills before that there was a lot of work. I mean, that's what the halt. There was 10, 15...
Yeah, so one additional piece of information. So the red area, sequence one, is pretty balanced.
Okay.
Sequence two, there is excess material, and when we're building sequence two, we will pile the material, and then when we're running out of room and we want to start building sequence three, that's a fill. In order to build the road of sequence three in the Northwest Village, we will move some of the material from sequence two using the Hall Road down to sequence three.
So this material is going to create the road for...
I think if you take that same thing and just overlay just sections of it pictorially, I'm going to understand how this thing's going to get built.
Sure, we can try better.
Sometimes
so,
I work
so
on,
really
on pictures better.
You, you want to see the order of operations of when these stockpiles are utilized.
That'll help me figure out where we are.
For you, Mr. Chairman, just one quick follow-up. So I think you guys explained it pretty well, that sequence two is going to feed sequence three. Is what's going to happen with three and four? Is four independent? Because you said one is self-contained.
Yeah. So,
do you know?
Four.
Or is it pretty final?
It's final. It's pretty self-contained. There's demolition work in sequence four that I know.
So for the most part, you're just moving sequence two to sequence three, Phil.
It is.
Okay. Yeah, I think four was.
They were, as we saw on the site walk, they're going to keep some of the buildings to act as storage shreds.
Yeah.
Storage shreds.
True.
Until completion of that section four.
But I think that was probably equipment. I would think.
Yeah, that's this green area that we're calling out as a staging area.
Right.
In sequence four.
And we also at the site walk, a couple of us had questions of which of those buildings are coming down now, as opposed to which are coming down later.
Let's see this green area. No.
And maybe that might be part of the. You know, if you're taking stuff down earlier than not, I mean, some of those buildings are almost dangerous.
Yeah.
But if you're going to use them, that's okay. But if you're not going to use them, get rid of them.
I think we're
stop paying taxes on them.
Determining now what these
changes. Okay.
If I may, through the chair.
I just want to make sure, and I know this is years down the road, but that staging area you just pointed out, we need to be very concerned about our neighbors on Fifth Street.
Mm-hmm. And that's to my point, is that with those storage areas, could they be fenced off so that people could not?
Well, actually, one of the reasons for leaving the buildings besides storage is the buildings actually act as a visual and sound buffer themselves,
mm-hmm.
because they block the neighbors on Fifth Street. The area we're talking about for the staging area is actually quite a bit lower.
Right.
It's that lower area with a couple of big concrete slabs, which is behind the buildings.
It's probably
the quietest and safest area you can do all that without.
It's the red bubble. Yeah, that's mm-hmm. under. It's on the lower side of the wall.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right. The wall. We've worked being right with the, here.
So we don't need to fence that off. Then you feel confident enough that.
I mean, if sometime you need it, you can do it. But I don't think you need it.
Well, one thing that we did notice. When we were walking was the graffiti and stuff that was there. Now, given that premise that there are people that frequent the area, and my concern would be safety of anybody that goes into that area and how accessibility would be a factor.
Yeah. I mean, I think we'll probably do some kind of conditions or put it in the construction management that those buildings that are remaining are, I'll say, secured in some way.
We're going to get secured very shortly.
Okay. I think we're... go ahead.
I just have one question. Could you show me the haul road between phase two and three?
Sure.
How are you going to get to three from two?
Yes.
Without using...
This line right here will be the haul road. So this would be one, two, and then the haul road connection is crossing Legacy Farms Road north here.
Okay.
And tying into basically what's an existing road right now. You'll recall from the site walk that we walked a good portion of this area, and that will connect us up to the later phases over here.
You're going to create some road in addition, some haul road in addition. Is that what you're saying?
No, the haul road is existing.
It's pretty well established.
You can see it right there.
One second.
Okay. So Matt, in your defense, 6 minutes was without questions, right?
Okay, so this yellow road is this yellow line is overlaid on the aerial to show the location of the haul road. So it's following existing trails essentially.
So
all the way up to.
So they will only cross Legacy Farm Road. They won't actually drive down.
Correct.
Right.
Correct.
And just cross right here.
Right.
Just one time.
Okay.
And I assume your construction management plan talks about signs in that crossing area. But anyway, we're out of time. Jennifer, what time do we continue this to?
You said 8:30 on 27th.
I think so.
What time? I'm sorry,
8:30 on the 27th.
It's 7:30. What do we have again?
Solar. I thought we had a lot on the 27th.
Let's put let's do a double book, because I'm not sure where the solar is going to get there, and I don't want to waste an hour.
Okay.
But we have another commitment, and you guys might be here early, and but let's do it at 7:30 at the same time to continue it. The solar area, they got to get through CONCOM.
Yep.
And if they don't get through CONCOM, I don't want to, you know, we will spend 5 minutes with them if they don't get through CONCOM. And I'm not 100% sure whether they'll make it or not.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I just want to comment that the outline works really well, and thank these guys for following the outline with the details. That was great.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. So I'm looking for a continuance, motion to continue the site plan review to June 27th at 7:30.
So moved.
Or make it, no, let's make it 7:35.
Just in case.
We don't want
them
waiting too long.
Well, it'll take us five minutes to continue the other one. Okay, it's moved, and I believe I heard a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Roy, before you leave, we've got you on the agenda for one other thing, and we'll take that up right now.
Oh, great.
Double poles, or I'm sorry, utility poles on Legacy North.
Yes.
Okay, thanks. Thank you.
Take care.
Thanks, guys. Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you.
Jen?
Just, okay. As part of the Eversource Verizon, etc. Royce sent me a plan that showed what was going on the North Road, and I noticed that there are two poles that this board has not approved at the entrance at near Wilson Street. Oh shoot, I never did send you the pictures for that. I took them. Oh well.
I think
they're on my phone.
I can phone them.
Yeah.
A nice looking pole.
As far as poles go, you're absolutely right.
Well,
we need a large screen. We can just slap up somebody's phone photo.
Anyway,
Jen.
Jen, that didn't get put in as a photo op on that?
Yeah, I forgot.
I didn't receive photos.
Yep.
You can pass on out if you like.
There's one pole.
That's a nice pole.
Can I give a little background?
You can give a little background, and then we'll go at it.
Okay.
Oh, you pass it down this way.
Sorry. Yeah, thank you.
The one on Wilson Street looks similar.
We're looking at.
Yeah. Yeah, they're very similar. They're right at the entrance.
You mean it looks like another telephone pole?
Yeah.
Oh.
So We've been working with We've been working with, as you probably can well imagine, Eversource for over a year to get the power onto the Legacy North. We've all seen the issues we've had with Eversource and Verizon, just trying to get poles relocated. We still have some that need to get relocated in Franklin. So very recently, they put in these two poles. One is at the entrance of Legacy on the Franklin side, and one is Legacy at the entrance on the Wilson side. So I called them up and I said, you know, why are these two poles here? And they said, well, we need these two poles, number one, because the poles on Franklin are not owned by us, they're owned by Verizon. And the Verizon poles will not let us put our three-phase power, if you will. We need to have our own pole. And I said, well, why can you run them underground from the other pole? Same reason, we need to have that pole if we're going to have that amount of power coming into the site. Told me the same thing on the other side of the street, being the Wilson Street side, and that's really all I've been told. They said the only way we can possibly get power on that street is to have these two poles, so we can run the three phase and then down the poles, and the 7,500 feet of Legacy Farms Road itself is all underground. It's just at the two main entrances.
Which of the older board members were around when we discussed that? I know I was. You guys were.
That was actually on May 23rd, 2010. I looked it up today.
That they were installed?
No. Yeah. That there was a item, I won't get this quite right, I think it was item 42, I think it was. Yeah. And basically it was said that you can replace existing poles where necessary, but Legacy Farms Road North is not to have poles on it.
Right.
That's so, the upshot.
So basically, these two poles are in violation of,
right.
of the approved plans. And I personally am not supportive of adding any more poles to this town than we have to. I mean, they cause us more trouble than that. That's why our bylaws insist upon everything to be underground. And, you know, we waived the three or four poles along, I'll say, the Old Franklin Road, Legacy North. Quite frankly, if we'd gone underground to that, it'd probably be built by now. That's where I'm coming from. I think it's going to take a vote of the board to approve these two.
Mr. Chairman, if I could, my concern is, I understand your desire, believe me, I don't like them. I brought this up with Eversource, and my concern is, knowing the bureaucracy that they are, if they were required to remove those poles, it wouldn't surprise me if I didn't get power, who knows, 6 months, a year. I mean, they're very punitive like that. They'll just say, well, we're going to go back to redesign. There will be 180 days to redesign it, and there'll be another 6 months to install it. I mean, it's just the way these people operate. I've been dealing with them literally for a year to get this far, to get in the queue to start pulling the wires.
Well, Verizon is on a strike right now anyway.
This is Eversource.
I
would request, if you would, to please approve the polls as much as we don't like them, because it'll be a tremendous, tremendous problem if we don't.
Yeah. Point of clarification through the chair.
Yeah.
There was a problem on Wilson Street with polls already with Verizon, and they cut some trees down to do pole maintenance.
They replaced all the poles on Wilson Street.
Yeah.
So Wilson Street, but
they did that for the LNG upgrade.
So the pole that we just looked at is actually on your property.
That's correct.
Yes, it's about.
That's a new pole.
I'll pick a number. It's like 40 feet into our property.
Oh, I thought it was more in a corner.
No,
which
no.
Made sense.
Well, it's, you know, maybe.
No, they have an existing Verizon pole right on the corner.
Yeah.
This is a new pole that they just drew up because they thought they were...
Because they want to put their switches up on top of a pole.
Yeah, they want to put the power on the pole because they can't put in a Verizon pole.
Which is nonsense because they share them throughout the whole...
My question is, why can't they put it on a Verizon pole? Because Verizon won't let them?
No.
They can put power on a Verizon pole, but apparently because of the amount of power for 425 homes, they need their own dedicated pole on both ends.
That doesn't make any engineering sense at all.
I'm just telling you.
All the power for the whole town goes right through in front of this building. It absolutely makes no sense at all. As far as I'm concerned, tell them to go pull them.
That'll delay this project for a year. I'm just telling you the way I'm dealing with here. I would respectfully ask you to please approve these two polls, because if we don't, it's going to be a hard show.
Yeah, go ahead.
I truly understand the dilemma, being a victim of trying to get Verizon to do anything is like pulling eye teeth. And I'm sure that these two poles are already established. Do we really?
I'm sitting, there's no wires to them at this point. It's a naked pole, and quite frankly, as far as I'm concerned, it's not according to the plan. It's not according to the master plan special permit.
They were put in violation.
And they're put in violation. And we don't rule. No. Mr. McDowell approved the plan that he paid for.
I didn't approve a plan. I was asked to pay for bringing power to the site. I have no control over how they do their plans.
Well.
And again,
we have control over the over poles that are on new streets. The selectmen have control over poles that are on existing accepted ways.
Yeah.
So unless somebody is willing to make a motion, we'd be happy to vote on it. If not, as far as I'm concerned, they stand as they are.
Point of clarification, a little bit more information. When were these poles put up?
Within the last month.
So
they're about ready to install power. We had to pay them a fortune to install this power through the road, and it's been in the queue for 9 months. And now that we're ready to go, if they have to remove these poles, God knows when the hell they'll do it. And I don't even know how they'll do it.
Never mind the poles. The way we want the power to come in is through
underground.
So
yeah, but I don't know. They'll be ripping up
streets
all over
the place. And that would be the poles that are on Wilson Street.
It's coming. They're bringing power from East Main Street down Franklin Road.
And poles? And poles?
No new poles. They're using existing poles.
Oh, yeah, that's what I mean. They're on poles, though. They're not underground.
No.
Sorry. There's a photo in your phone, and I saw one. Paul, I thought that was on Wilson Street.
That's on Franklin.
No, that was on Franklin.
Right. It's the equivalent.
At the beginning of...
Yeah, way at the bottom, yeah.
Okay. So, all right. Either way, they did the wrong thing.
Well, they did the wrong thing relative to what the Master Plan Special Permit says.
Right.
What I'm simply saying is they're saying this is what they need to do to bring me power.
Well, that's absolute engineering nonsense. I mean, they do underground wires and switch gears and whatever. Most, you can do it all over the time.
If I may,
yeah.
What's the alternative to that? Is it a platform that would bring...
I have no idea what the alternative is, because they told me they don't have one. I'm just telling you what I'm saying. Yeah.
No, I understand.
You've dealt with these people.
It's got to be a box on the ground.
It has to be a box.
It's a box on the ground, or they put the switchgear up on the other pole. The existing pole.
Not the new pole.
Yeah.
So, Roy, I feel for your concern that it's going to push back the project, but I have to agree with Ken that, I mean, we put our utilities underground for lots of reasons. For aesthetics, for, continuity and, trees taking down power lines. I mean, that's we do it for aesthetics, too, so, I mean, I have to support that.
Kind of a rule of thumb. He breaks it, fixes it. So if they put these poles up, they can take them down.
It's going to be nice sort of going into a new development and looking at wires over your head.
Where is the next closest pole? You said they were existing already.
40 feet away, 30 feet away.
Is it across Franklin Road?
Again, you're asking me, the ones on Franklin Road are all Verizon poles. I'm not sure about the ones on Wilson. When I saw the poles go up, I was kind of surprised. I called them up and asked them. I said, this is what we need to do to bring the power to
the
They were
Verizon poles on Wilson, because I think we went to them when they took down the tree to take them, if I remember correctly.
They told me they can string up wires in a Verizon pole, but they can't put their, I don't know if it's transformer or whatever you want to call it.
That'll even make it worse.
Across Wilson Street, I mean, that's Eversource property. They can't put a unit on their own property.
Well, not Wilson Street. This is Franklin.
I know it's on Roy's property, but they can't do something on their own property.
It's not their property.
No, what he's saying. What I think Brian's saying, if I may.
We got a lot of work yet.
Yeah.
Let's. Is anyone willing to take a motion to allow to reconsider allowing these poles?
I make a motion.
Is there a second? Seeing no second, we'll consider this closed. Okay. Let's see. Connelly Hill Estates, request for bond release for 53G and bond funds. We approve those roads. You recommend approval of releasing of the bond funds and the 53G account?
Yes.
Do I entertain a motion to release the bond funds and the 53G amount?
Quick discussion.
Go ahead.
How many roads is this? Like, do you have road names?
It's
I know it's part of Springwoods, right?
It's the road that's been
accepted by town meeting.
Okay. If you don't know off the top of your head, I'm fine with it. I'm fine.
I'm sorry.
This is the one we accepted at town meeting.
Okay,
yeah,
I'm fine with it.
I think it's 15, I believe.
Yeah.
No, I'm sorry.
I have a point of question for clarification. There's $100 in the 53G account.
I think it's and.
At.
Oh, I'm sorry. It should be and.
Okay.
Yeah.
$12,000 bond.
So, anyway, we're releasing the whole bond and the 53. Did we have a motion for that effect?
So moved.
Moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote? Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay, this is a request for release of bond funds for Christian Way. I believe you have a recommendation from the engineer not to?
Well, it wasn't really so much a recommendation not to. He had felt that there was other areas that needed attention. So.
And we're holding about $1,100 or something?
$1,200. So it's probably not worth releasing at this time.
I think until he fixes the last items, we hold the bond.
So, Mr. Chairman, yep. What's the quick history on this? Is there a new development on this road? Or
there's a couple of houses on it. I think it's a small cul-de-sac. It's a private road. It's kind of a gravel-type road. It's.
But when was the development done that we're holding the bond?
It was built last year.
Last year, okay.
It's still ongoing.
It's like 193.
Okay. Approval not required plan for 4 and 8 Linden Street. This is to kind of change some land from one person to another.
Do we need to take a vote on Christian Way?
Oh, you're
No.
Okay.
I have the plan. The one neighbor is just selling some land to the other neighbor.
This is an approval not required plan. Both lots meet the frontage requirements, etc.
Right, the parcel that they're deeding does not, obviously, but
okay.
Both lots will still be buildable lots.
I have this is off Curtis. Where's Curtis?
Curtis is right near Legacy Farms.
Yes. Thank you, Legacy Farms.
Behind.
Yes.
So, which one are we speaking of now?
Number 6.
So it's just this little triangle, this rectangle right here.
Is going from
4 to 8.
To square off the lot?
No. He didn't tell me why. He just...
He sold it to his neighbor because his neighbor wants to do something, I guess. I don't know. Doesn't... And they have frontage and they have area. And if we wouldn't approve it, the town clerk would approve it after a couple of... Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries.
How many
just...
Two signatures.
Just the Mylar.
Okay. Now we're on Foxhollow Road, which I think you guys are waiting for.
We are. I will take none of your time, I promise you. I'll do this very quickly.
Okay.
By none you mean very little, right?
Yes. Little as possible.
This is to establish a performance bond so that he can release lots on Foxhollow Road, and that is the 203 Pond Street cul-de-sac.
Correct.
The old Coolidge is
That's
up.
Correct.
Okay. Where they're building new houses now?
Yes.
How many houses in development, roughly?
12. Two are on Pond Street,
okay.
And those two are already up, and the other two are on the new road
that's going in?
10 in the back.
In the back.
In the back, yes. So there's two on Pond Street now, those are in, there's 10 more going in, out behind the crossing that we just finished. Binder has been placed. So all the utility infrastructure is in, well, for the hard stuff, save the electrical and the cable, telephone, stuff like that. We have submitted a bond estimate to FST, or Stantec now, as I always forget to call them. They reviewed, they responded, they thought our numbers were a little bit low, they've given some new numbers. We're not contesting it.
Sorry, can you introduce yourself?
Oh, my apologies.
He's doing
new board, excuse me. Eric Dias, registered professional engineer with Strong Point Engineering. We are also the people who did the original design on this subdivision.
Thanks.
Okay. So, where do I have that?
Right here.
Sheet.
The
new sheet.
Okay.
So basically, for the new board members, in order for them to start selling lots, we require them to bond the work so that if something would happen, that somebody that has a lot along the street isn't stuck with a mess, because we could then take the money and finish it, which we have occasionally had to do, not so much recently, but in the past that has happened. So I believe the new word number we're looking at is 100 or 201 in 318. And
so do we need to increase?
No, that's
with.
Well, that would be the new number. But before we get going towards approval of this, explain to me why you sold one of the lots in violation of the condition that was set up.
You know, I will be honest with you, I am the engineer on the project. I cannot explain to you why that happened. What I can say is that it appears to have been an honest mistake to the extent that there are those. It also made its way through the seller and the buyer's attorney, which I was a little surprised about. A title search usually tells you that these things are not really open for sale yet. That said, there is no lot release on that lot, so no house could be built on it until this board decides so, which is, kind of rolls it into the remainder of the 10 that we, the other 9 that we have before us tonight.
I don't know, I'm just, did that mean that somebody didn't file the condition and then record it?
I believe the subdivision approval was recorded.
It's been recorded.
And that was included on that. And two attorneys screwed it up.
I was surprised to find out myself, to be honest.
Being the case, though, money has changed hands, and there to move the project forward, the rest of this stuff has to happen. So.
Yeah, right. This does need to happen.
Okay, let's do it one at a time. We entertain a motion to set the bond for Foxhollow Road at $201,318.
So moved.
And is that the motion I need? Just to make.
Yeah, that doesn't include, typically the board includes a $5,000 like administrative legal fee line item in case you have to take the bond, but that's not included in here. Nope. So I don't know if you wanted to.
Can
we
get that out of the contingency?
So it would technically be 206.
Okay, so the motion would be $206,000 for the bond.
Amend to 206-318.
Okay. Take everyone. Take it. Okay. There's motion. Did I hear
second?
A second? I hear a second. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries.
And then you want to vote to release all the lots contingent upon receipt of bond in proper form.
Do you want all of them released at this time?
We do.
You're sure?
We're sure.
Okay.
Can we not release one that was sold?
Please don't do that.
Well, some people don't want them released until they want to build them because you pay taxes on them higher.
I understand. At this point, and I should have introduced, this is Ryan Norton. He is the site supervisor on the project. We do anticipate going pretty quickly now that we've got our crossing in, we've got the binder down. I think if we were to not release them all, we would simply be back here in a short amount of time asking to release the rest.
Okay.
And once they've bonded the entire room, there really isn't a reason to
it's more their
taxes.
Their standpoint.
No.
How does it affect the taxes?
I think they go up once they're released lots.
Once the lots are released, the taxes do start to increase. I do believe.
We have one developer that comes in every other month asking for
one or two lots at a time.
Just as he wants to build them, he's here like the month before.
Does anybody know how much it affects the taxes, or?
I have no clue, but he goes through all this hassle because of it, and that's the only thing I'm trying to be nice about.
Is it an amortized?
I don't care. It'll take out less of my life if I release all 10 of them.
And that doesn't change, so say I wanted 6 lots now, it doesn't affect the bond amount?
Nope.
No. Bond amount stays the same, we would just have to come back and request the next 4 when we're ready to build them, and the only savings that we would have for it is the tax implications. So really, it depends on...
When you have to specify which 6 lots you
which 6 we want, correct. Which gives us less flexibility in bargaining as we move forward.
We'll just go along.
Okay. So the motion is to release all 10 lots on Foxhollow Road subject to receipt of the bond in proper form in this office, or in the planning office. Looking for a motion for that.
Motion.
It's moved, seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. And is that something I can sign later on, if I remember?
We'll have to do a forming A to sign it. We didn't know how it was going to play out. So.
Okay.
Can you get a second signature?
Just a matter of administration, if I may. I know we've got a couple of aggressive timelines for a couple of units to deliver. What kind of timeline are we looking at to be able to, once we give the bond, obviously, that needs to happen, is it a... Do we have to wait for another planning board meeting, or is it...
No, you shouldn't, because they just took both the votes. So if we can get the form done up this week,
right,
and you can get us the bond, we can...
The Form K has to be signed.
The Form K has to be signed, so we'll do our best to get that signed before
great
the next... If I can't get them to come in before the next planning board meeting, then it might have to...
How many people have to sign that form?
A majority.
Oh, okay, so it's a...
5.
Okay.
Point of order, Mr. Chair, on the bond. That $5,000 administrative fee for filing, is that before the 20% contingency? Or
separate?
I think it's separate.
Because I was saying, because then we'd be looking at 207-307.
Yeah, no, the one I looked at, it was separate.
Okay.
It was like after.
Perfect.
Okay. And with regard to that, just a point of order, that will be in the last request that we request that we'll come back done.
No, I apologize, I don't have my reading glasses, I overlooked one thing. Because of the previous misstep, the one lot, we're maybe looking for how can you make amends to the community.
I think we're beyond that at this point.
True, but looking for maybe some additional trees on Pond Street, which is...
There's a lot of trees up on
Street. It's pretty well treed now. Yeah,
let's get going, because I got about 15 minutes more stuff, and I don't like keeping going. And if you work off your punch list, we're reasonable about if the engineer signs off on it, we'll reduce the bond.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So we'll get working on this quickly.
Good luck.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you.
Good luck, guys.
Okay. We received a request for extension of time to issue a decision on stormwater permit for the Hayden Rowe facility.
Yes. That's
Jennifer?
Yes, I'm sorry. So the time to issue the decision for the stormwater management permit for the 201 project. So our project was today. It ends today. So we had a letter from our courthouse office requesting an extension until July 25th.
So, do we have to vote that?
Yes.
So what is the form of the motion?
It's you're making a motion to extend the time to issue a decision for the stormwater management permit for 201 Hayden Road stormwater.
I move.
File
the
decision.
Second.
Second. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote? Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. Okay.
You can keep up.
End of the year budget status. We have, I believe, it's $4,500 left in the planning board kitty.
I have a suggestion.
The intention was potentially to use that to do the engineering for the right turn lane onto Lumber Street, phase one. Jennifer had it outlined in her memo, pretty much except for we've already done the easement.
Except, so I spoke, after you and I spoke today, yeah. I spoke to Wayne, the easements aren't completed. We have not done them yet.
What do you mean we haven't done them?
From Cumberland Farms, and they've not been.
Well, recording is not anything we're going to need an engineer to do.
185 West Main Street hasn't been done yet. You only did an easement from Cumberland Farms. You didn't do the 185 West Main Street yet.
Well, that was a condition of site plan approval.
Right, that was
the fact that he hasn't recorded it is a administrative problem.
I don't think he's drawn it up yet.
Yeah, it was in the plan.
Okay, because she's very worried about that one. But
well, she should be worried about it because it got built and the building inspector gave him site plan approval without having the easement recorded.
All right, well, they're coming in on the 27th, so we can talk to them about that. But she also...
And quite frankly, they owe us the easement if they don't have the plan, but I think they have the plan.
I'm trying to find the actual amount here now. She sent me the amount for Beta's proposal was $22,000.
That's too much.
One.
That's too much. We're not doing Beta's.
Correct, but her point is it's not going to come down to $4,500 from anybody. Like from $22,000 to $4,500, that's a significant gap.
If you take the drawing that's available for the rest of the work that's being done in front of Cliff's house and add a lane for conceptual, I can't imagine that it takes me more than, and I'm not good at AutoCAD, more than 5 hours to put it together. I just don't see this as, I think Beta was overthinking the problem from a conceptual standpoint. We're looking for conceptual and a budget. We're not looking for construction drawings.
When we went through the whole Lumber Street and 85 West Main Street projects, there was a plan there that showed the easement from 85 West Main. We're just, at this point, looking for a continuation to Cumberland Farms.
And we got that at town meeting.
Right.
A small piece.
It's been drawn up at some level.
So it's been a couple weeks. Maybe working with Elaine.
I want to see it go out to bid for our next meeting and talk to these people and get it done. Because otherwise, we're going to screw around with this thing. It's got to get at the hop of Elaine's list if she's the one that's doing it, or Dave. You know, we don't want to miss a construction season because we're dinking around on it. And I would first go to the guy that's doing the work for Paul.
That's who they're for MDM. They're going to MDM for the next quarter. That's who you're at.
Ask MDM to add 200 feet of lane onto their plan. They got to have the plan. If you can't do that in for $4,000, something's wrong.
Okay.
Easy money.
I mean,
so that kind of takes away my next question, Jeff.
Yeah.
Was that money be allocated towards the Cedar Street, Main Street intersect?
That's already taken care of. Selectmen have money from that as part of Legacy Farms, 100% design review. That's already been done.
Excellent.
Okay.
The question is, the scope that's listed here from Elaine and Dave, does this make sense from what we're asking?
The only thing is the plan of easements is not needed from Cumberland Farms. The temporary easements might be added into phase two. You know, because you got to do the engineering design before you know whether you need a construction easement.
So that clarifies that our request is here.
Yep.
And we're expecting an answer in the next meeting.
We're expecting to get going on it. Yeah. Okay, we're going to skip the master plan for economic development because Fran's not here, but I know Frank was ready to talk about it, but we'll talk about that in our next one.
That's a pre-10 p.m.
What?
That's a pre-10 p.m.
Yes,
topic.
Yes, absolutely. That type of stuff doesn't get done at the Liaison. Approve the minutes for the April 11th, 2016. Any comments, questions on the minutes? By the way, people that weren't even members of that thing can vote on it. As new members, you're just kind of approving whether you like it or not.
I like it.
Yeah, it's wonderful.
Looking for a motion to approve, because unless you move.
Second.
Further discussion, seeing none, how do you vote? Aye. Anyone opposed, anyone approved, or anyone abstain, motion carries. So we're that. Fair. Okay. Now we've got stuff on the back. Peer review proposals. I finally read it. I passed it off to John. He's next on the list. You read it? You're halfway through. Elaine says she finished.
I'm halfway through.
Okay, and I have my notes here, so we will continue that to the next meeting.
Peer review, can someone enlighten me, please?
When data comes in and reviews what the applicant does, we're talking about the contract for them.
Okay.
And basically, we don't spend most of that money, but we're spending the applicant's money to do it, so we want to keep it reasonable, but we also, but we've had beta for like 3 years lately, I believe, and we're going to see whether we continue. There's one other item that I wanted to bring up that kind of went along with the issue of double poles,
okay.
And it's kind of a little bit Roy's frustration of dealing with Eversource. There was an article back in March that I happened to dig out that Representative Chris Walsh from Framingham had proposed a way to fine the utilities for not being responsive to towns, and both on double poles and double poles also the double pole when they're kind of merged together to fix it.
And laced together.
But also the double pole that's out in the middle of Cedar Street is considered a double pole for this whole thing. I would request that Jennifer or Elaine contact Representative Walsh, get a copy of what he filed for legislation, and we will then maybe at our next meeting propose that either us or the selectmen take this legislation and go to Karen Dykema and Senator Spilka and say, hey, this is a good idea. Let's get going on it. I'm sure they had more than a little bit of pushback from Verizon and Eversource and all the other utilities. But, you know, we're not alone in this frustration that they have. And I even talked to the chairman of the DPU, which we sent an email to, which we never got a response to either. But anyway, this...
Both Carol and Karen have sent us congratulations letter. Carol has put her cell phone number on there, so I'm all set with that if you need her again.
Okay. Any other future agenda items?
I got both.
Well, I think you just going unelected, folks.
Yes.
From what I understand, school building committee has submitted the plans.
You understand correct, my friend.
And so,
when is that coming?
July 11th.
Well, they want to be open, what, next September or year, what's 18?
There will be significant pressure to add to that. We might have to schedule another July meeting.
You're going to want to go quickly.
And there's a lot of issues, perhaps, with it, too. So,
that's
so,
I believe.
So,
their meeting was CONCOM, I think, in late June. So.
Should we rush it, or should we do it correctly?
We will correctly. Do it correctly as fast as we can. Anyone has future agenda items that you want, let me know. I'm always happy to try to put them on the agenda, and hopefully we'll rush through it. And I apologize for keeping you 12 minutes beyond what I normally do.
Can we get overtime?
Well, you did real good tonight.
Can I just put a food for thought out?
Yeah.
Out there, food for thought. We're spending a lot of money on sidewalks. I was thinking about entertaining the possibility of the town doing the sidewalks themselves. We have all the equipment.
Yeah, he had, I think that's agreeable on my aspect, too.
We don't need to discuss it now, just think about it.
Who did the sidewalks on West Main?
Let's add that sidewalk discussion.
We're paying $150 a foot.
For our equipment.
No, for the ones we already got done, so that's $1,500.
We'll talk about it at the end.
The next meeting, you're going to get the sidewalk survey.
So tie in with that.
Motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Moved, seconded. Any discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote? Aye.
Aye, aye, aye.
Good job, Ken.
I can't, I got to go pick up my kids.
You're fighting tonight.